God is holy. What God is great like you? For you work mighty wonders. Your power is seen in all you do. When I whisper in the night, do you hear me?
When I call upon your name, do you hear my voice? I will remember my song in the night. I will remember your deeds, O Lord, when your plan is not in sight. Let me remember all that you've done. Your way, O God, is holy. Your path runs through the storm. Though the earth is shaking, you hold your children in your arms. When I cry out in the day, do you hear me? When I call upon your name, do you hear my voice? I will remember my song in the night. I will remember your deeds, O Lord, when your plan is not in sight. Let me remember all that you've done. My song in the night, I will remember your deeds, O Lord, when your plan is not in sight. Let me remember all that you've done.
Help of the helpless, so abide. sing, where thy victory. I triumph still if thou abide with me. Hold thou thy cross before my clothes. Shine through the gloom and point me to the stars. As morning breaks and earth's faint shadows flee, in life, in death,
we continue in service, we remember our baptism. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in the resurrection like his. Friends, as we continue in worship this morning, we turn our attention now to the hymnal, the Lutheran Book of Worship. And there in hymn 448, we're going to sing verses 1 and 4 of this beautiful hymn, Amazing Grace. You're invited to join as we sing, as we praise God with these words. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our brother Paul. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us your aid so we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our course on earth in confidence until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I want to invite three hearts to come and share with all of you some personal reflections. I want to invite Krista to come and share what she has on her heart this morning.
Hello. My name is Krista. I'm honored to have been asked to help pay tribute to Paul today. And I want to thank everybody here for coming. Your attendance speaks volumes about the impact that this wonderful man has had on all of us. I have known my entire life that Paul had to exist. But I did not know who he was, nor did I get a chance to meet him until about 5 years ago. 5 very short years. I am a seeker of knowledge, and I really thought just knowing who he was enough. And it was just the beginning. When I met him, the love that man exuded filled that final puzzle piece in my heart that had been missing for so long. It is often said that the hour of death cannot be forecasted. And when we say this, we imagine this hour to be in the far distant future. And while it was clear that after 88 beautiful years that Paul's life here on earth was winding down, I do not think any of us thought it would have come quite as soon as it did. Throughout my life, I have experienced the loss of friends and many family members. I come from a very large family. And I've always found myself feeling very guilty over my grief. I've always been extremely aware and sensitive to the grief of others and always questioning my right to grieve with them, thinking that their loss was greater than mine. And as I sat and reflected on Paul and what his presence in my life meant to me, I realized for the first time, and to my very great surprise, that I had been looking at grief all wrong. What I realized in that moment is that this grief that I'm feeling is a privilege. Our grief is an indication of how deeply an individual has impacted our lives. And for me, quite simply, the fact that I'm standing here today with my family to celebrate the life of Paul and grieve with you all is no less than a miracle in so many ways. Okay. So, as I sat in my grief, I asked myself, the question that popped into my head was, how do you take a measure of a man? How do you determine what a person's legacy is? What is Paul's legacy? After I volunteered to speak, I did what I often do when I'm faced with having to give a speech, and I Googled. Because there are millions of people out there that have said things way better than I ever could. And so I typed in quotes, measure of a man. And lo and behold, there were 110 million results. So after reading just a few hundred, I briefly debated doing this data visualization with a PowerPoint and maybe a poster. And if anybody knows, I'm a demographer, I'm a scientist, and that's right up my alley, but I didn't think you guys would all want to sit through that PowerPoint presentation. So instead, I found three that really stood out to me, that really spoke to my heart about capturing how I saw Paul. I just hope that the way I saw him honors him the way that you all who knew him so much better. So the first was said by Martin Luther King, and he said that the measure of a man is not how he behaves in the moments of comfort and convenience, but in how he stands at times of controversy and challenges. Then Eric Banks said that the measure of a man is in the lives that he's touched. And then finally, Fred Small declared that the only measure of your worth and your deeds will be the love that you leave behind when you're gone. And then, as I do, I had to simplify that even further, and I just broke it down to four words that I really feel embody the man that I did get to know a little bit. And those are integrity, friends, family, and love. So, what is Paul's legacy? I look around myself today, and I look at all of you, and his legacy is us. Each and every single one of us, we are Paul's legacy. We are all part of that constellation of Paul's love. A love that enveloped him and those around him in both life and now in death. The love survived the challenges of life. That love touched each and every one of us. And although his body is gone, his love will live on.
Amen. Amen. I want to invite Christine now to come and to share her heart with you all.
Patient. Able to accept or tolerate delays, problems, or suffering without becoming annoyed or anxious. Selflessness, concern more with the needs and wishes of others than one's own. Gracious, courteous, kind, and pleasant. Loyal, giving or showing firm and consistent support or allegiance to a person or institution. Devoted, very loving or loyal. Extraordinary, very unusual or remarkable. Grandpa, you had the most patience I've ever seen anyone have, especially towards your glenadine. You were the most selfless man I've ever known. Anyone who knew you and conversed with you experienced how gracious you were. You always asked people how they were and how their family was and actually cared to know. You didn't just ask to ask, you genuinely cared. You were always a joy to be around and spend time with or drink a beer or two with. The loyalty of your faith and to your family was astonishing. You were a devoted patriot and patriot. A devoted husband, father, grandfather, great-grandfather, uncle, brother, brother-in-law, neighbor, friend, Ohio State fan, Cleveland Indian fan, and I'm sure more I'm forgetting. Grandpa, you were just extraordinary. You were simply the best. As my brother James said, they don't make men like you anymore. You and Grandma were quite the pair. You enjoyed life and lived it to the fullest. You loved your family hard, and we always knew how special and important we were to you. You guys always showed up for everything, and Grandpa, you continued to without Grandma. And I know it wasn't easy. I know it was so hard losing her. I could see it in your eyes. I wonder who was more excited, Grandma to see you or you to see Grandma. Mom said she's sure Grandma shook her finger at you and said, "What took you so long, Polly?" And you probably replied, "I'm sorry, dear. I accidentally got on the slow train." A good friend of yours said you had 4 years to be in charge, but you're not the boss anymore, Grandpa. Glenadine is again. It's only been 5 days. And you were missed terribly. Life absolutely will not be the same without you. And it hurts so bad. But knowing you are where you want to be, with the love of your life again, pain-free, is a comfort I'm trying to hold on strong to. I know you don't want anyone to be sad. You want us to celebrate your life and keep on living our best lives like you and Grandma did. I promise I'm going to try my best to live that way and try to continue to make you both proud. I've always been blessed and proud to say I'm Paul and Glenadine Berner's granddaughter.
Invite David to come and share.
So for those that you may not know, I am David. This is not David. This is my daughter, Jessica. But a couple days ago, she penned this beautiful letter to her grandpa, and a lot in that letter was, you know, what I would want to convey, and I thought, I can't do it any better than what she did, so I asked her if she would be kind enough and gracious enough to share that with you.
I was going to write you a letter. I was going to tell you everything you meant to me, or at least try to somehow put it into words. I was going to try and help give you one last Father's Day party. I was going to come see you every other weekend until whenever the cancer took you from us. I was going to hold your hand when there was nothing left to hold on to. I was going to do so many things. Grandpa, you were so much more to all of us than we can ever put into words. Your quiet, patient strength was a rock that our family could always rest on. Your work ethic, loyalty, and humility inspired us. Your love, sense of humor, and creativity brought us so much joy. None of us ever doubted that you loved us or that you were proud of us. And as if all of that wasn't enough to adore you for, the past 5 years of your life were filled with so much opportunity for you to emulate the love of Christ to your family and for us to admire you more and more. The way you cared for Grandma as she made her long journey home demonstrated so much sacrificial love and loyalty to all of us. You never once wavered in your devotion and care to her, no matter how difficult it got, and you never stopped loving her after she was gone. And the way you received a daughter that you had never known about, along with another son-in-law, 4 more grandchildren, and 11 more great-grandchildren into our family with open arms, is one of the greatest lasting gifts you could have given us. From the time we met them, you never once gave any indication to me that they weren't a part of our family, which was the way we all wanted it. our family may have just gotten smaller in a heartbreaking way, but it's also so much bigger than we ever could have imagined it would be more than 5 years ago. And the way you embrace that earth-shifting change with love and openness and put aside your own initial discomfort for the sake of the entirety of your family was such a testament to all of us of how to love and live well. It made me even prouder to be your granddaughter than I already was, which I didn't even think was possible before that. I love you, Grandpa. I love you so much. I would give anything to just go back and have one more conversation with you, to hug you a little longer next time. I wish I would have followed you back into the living room just 10 days ago and stretched that moment out just a little longer like I felt compelled to do, but I thought I had more time. We all thought we had more time. Thank you for being the husband that loved patiently, joyfully, and unconditionally. Thank you for being the supportive, encouraging, and welcoming father that you were. Thank you for being the grandfather that shaped our lives in unforgettable ways. Thank you for being the great-grandfather that was always interested in the lives of your great-grandchildren and made a point to engage and have fun with them. Thank you for being the man that showed us all how to love well, often, and forever. Thank you for the legacy that you left for all of us. I hope we made you even half as proud as you made us. I'm pretty sure we did. I love you. I love you. I love you.
And to try and sum this up, not really sum it up a little bit, but just a couple of my thoughts, that last Saturday when a series of phone calls started and we received that word that Dad did pass, for each one that got that phone call or heard the word on the street or whatever, our lives, our world changed in that split second, that brief moment. The world changed in many different ways. For the kids and the grandkids and the great-grandkids, it's the loss of that individual, that person. For, I think of around town, I think of the bowling alley and the Deshler Legion, it's a loss of a patron, a devoted patron that spent a lot of time there showing up for a meal. And probably just as much just to visit with whoever he would see at those places. And through the visitation yesterday and just receiving word, so many people talked about how they enjoyed seeing him at the bowling alley or the Legion and spending time with him and chatting with him, maybe having a beer with him or whatever it may be. Around town, the world has changed for those getting used to see a man ride around on his bicycle. There's one less person on a bicycle riding around town. And again, it was another thing that I heard so many times of people talking about. They love to see him on his bike, or we just saw him on his bike, you know, that shock, the initial shock of what happened. And probably one of the most important is what he affectionately called the office or the University of Useless Knowledge. And for those of you that are familiar with that, that's Mr. Sager and his cohorts downtown, that Dad loved to go up there every opportunity he had, and it was several, probably daily at different times. And, you know, he had different ways of explaining what they did. You know, one of them was we solve the world's problems. Another one is we lie to each other for a couple hours and we all go our separate ways. But for that, there's one less professor at that university to be able to share that knowledge or try and solve those problems. And just to kind of add a little bit more, there was when Mom passed, had the opportunity to share at her funeral, and it was started out what we call Glennyisms. For those that knew Mom, she always had these different phrases, and she had a boatload of them, and she had one for about every situation imaginable. And she never ceased to take the opportunity to share those, whether you wanted to hear it or not, but they were all fun. But Dad was not that way. He didn't have all of that. He was the quiet, humble type. Not that Mom was not humble, but she definitely was not quiet. She liked to have a good time. But there was one that, there's a couple, the one that he said, and he kind of shared probably most in the past few months, and that is, whatever's going to happen is going to happen, is meant to happen. And I'm kind of paraphrasing, but to us it was his way of recognizing God's sovereignty and as we would talk about things, especially when we found out he was sick. And, you know, he would say, he said, I don't want you to be sad. I want you to be happy. He said, I have no regrets. He says, I have no complaints. I've lived a good life. I have a great family that he was very proud of. And so again, that was just, you know, a sign, a picture of God's sovereignty. And then the other one that I remember when I was a kid, and this is one that I had always had a hard time with, especially as a kid, being a sports fan and being a competitive sports fan. And he would always say, somebody's got to win and somebody's got to lose. And it seemed that the times that hurt the most is when my team lost. Whether it was Patrick Henry as a young kid, whether it was the Buckeyes in a big game, whether it was the Browns in a big game. I just like, Dad, stop. I get it. Quit saying that. But, you know, he always never ceased to tell me that. And in the end, we had our weekly card game, and he would bring that up, especially when he was winning. And he would say, you know, Dave, somebody's got to win, somebody's got to lose. Or if it's, you know, getting down to the end and it's like, okay, what do I bid? Do I go for it all? Do I take a chance on getting set? And he'd say, somebody's got to win, somebody's got to lose. But I just know that, Dad, you won. There's no loser in this game, and Dad lived life well. And I just kind of want to end with scripture that kind of reminds me of that victory. It's from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Job well done, Dad.
Three messages of love, of strength, and of courage. A reminder that even on this day of great sorrow, there may be joy in your hearts as you remember and celebrate the gifts that Paul has given to all of you. Because it will not end, yet it will continue. And you will share that with the world. I want to read to you two passages. The first comes from the book of Psalms, in the 71st Psalm, these words. In you, O Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock of refuge, a strong fortress. To save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Rescue me, O God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and cruel, for you, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth. Upon you I have learned from my birth. It was you who took me from my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you. I have been like a portent to many. But you are my strong refuge. My mouth is filled with your praise and with your glory all day long. Do not cast me off in the time of old age. Do not forsake me when my strength is spent. For my enemies speak concerning me, and those who watch over my life consult together. They say, pursue and seize that person whom God has forsaken, for there is no one to deliver. O God, do not be far from me. O my God, make haste to help me. Let my accusers be put to shame and consumed. Let those who seek to hurt me be covered with scorn and disgrace. But I will hope continually and will praise you yet more and more. My mouth will tell of your righteous acts, of your deeds of salvation all day long. Through their number is past my knowledge. I will come praising the mighty deeds of the Lord God. I will praise your righteousness, yours alone. O God, from my youth you have taught me, and I still proclaim your wondrous deeds. So even to old age and gray hairs, O God, do not forsake me. Until I proclaim your might to all generations to come, your power and your righteousness, O God, reach the high heavens, you who have done great things. O God, who is like you? You who have made me see many troubles and calamities will revive me again from the depths of the earth. You will bring me up again. You will increase my honor and comfort me once again. I will also praise you with the harp for your faithfulness, O my God. I will sing praises to you with the lyre, O Holy One of Israel. My lips will shout for joy when I sing praises to you, my soul also, which you have rescued. All day long my tongue will talk of your righteous help for those who tried to help me harm. You have been put them to shame and disgrace. A second reading comes from Peter's letter, 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 9, a reminder of the living hope of Jesus Christ. Hear these words. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold that through perishable is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice in the indescribable and glorious love, for you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. These two particular readings from Psalm 71 and from 1 Peter remind us how that it is God on this day. It is God in which your strength to share these beautiful testimonies, to sing and praise God for the gift he gave to each of you in Paul, the gift that he will continue to give each of you, what Paul has instilled in you, which is love. That love will not fade from this day. As another gift, Paul's grandchildren will come again and once again sing and provide love to all of us in these precious words, in this song titled Always Good.
Do you remember how Mary was grieving? How she wept and she fell at your feet? If it's true that you know what I'm feeling, could it be that you're weeping with me? Arise, O Lord, and save me. There's nowhere else to go. You're always good, always good. Somehow this sorrow is shaping my heart like it should. You're always good, always good. Well, it's so hard
to know what you're doing, so why won't you tell it all plain? You said you'd come back on the third day, Peter missed it again and again.
So maybe the answer surrounds us, but we don't have eyes to see that you're always good. Is moving me closer than joy ever could. You're always good. My God, my God, be near me. There's nowhere else to go. And Lord, if you can hear me, please help your child to know that you're always good, always good. As we try to believe what is not meant to be understood, will you help us to trust your intentions for us are still good? 'Cause you laid down your life and you suffered like I never could. You're always good. Always good. You're always good, always good.
I'm honored to be able to share a word of encouragement with you and a word of hope. As one who mourns and grieves Paul's passing along with each of you, for each of us, Paul meant something special. To some, he was a father. Some, he was an uncle. To some, he was a brother-in-law. To others, grandfather. To some, great-grandfather. To others, a neighbor, and to many, a friend. To me, he was grandpa. That's not entirely the truth. Probably the first several years of my life, I thought that because his name was Paul, and we called him grandpa, that we were actually calling him Grand Paul, because I thought he was pretty grand myself. So I'll just use those two names interchangeably. I hope by now all of us have been able to see the video that shows Paul's best-kept secret, his talent for building model airplanes. I love how that video says so many things about who Paul was. It shows how patient he was. It shows how deliberate he was, as sometimes he is so focused on what he's doing, but when he speaks, he says something intentional and true. shows how humble and self-effacing Paul is. I don't think anybody would be surprised to know how much of a struggle it was for Paul's grandson, Keegan, to get him to even agree to have his hands in front of the camera, much less to talk for the recording. I think many of us didn't even know about this hobby of Paul's for many years. And I personally know next to nothing about building model planes, but I gather based on the many models that Paul built that he was something of an expert. I'd love to imagine how he would just lay out the plans for a model aircraft and work each step of the process with precision and with care. And while we see something of that process in the video, and while we see the beautiful finished project, I think what we probably don't see is all of the times through the years that things didn't quite go according to plan. You know, I don't think we saw all the punctured fuselages or the smudged paint or the crooked decals. And I don't know this for sure, but I suspect that we didn't see that time when part J wasn't actually supposed to fit into slot E, but the glue had already dried, and so Grandpa was happy that for the moment there weren't any grandkids within earshot. What do we do when things don't go according to the plan? For each of us, Paul's death interrupted our plans. Many of us had plans to meet with him again and reminisce about old stories or ask pressing questions. Some of us had plans to write letters to Paul or to take photos with him. Some of us had travel plans to fly in or drive in from out of state to see him. Some of us had weekly plans to stop in for another regular visit. We had plans to share one more hug or one more secret handshake, plans to share thoughts and feelings with Paul that we would have wanted him to know before the end. Whatever interruption to these plans we experienced, it's left us with many different feelings about Paul's passing. For some of us, we simply feel shocked. Some of us feel angry or confused. Some of us feel sad, exhausted. Some of us are struggling with regret and self-blame. Because this disruption we're experiencing, a disruption of what we hoped would be many more months or weeks or days with Paul, it's more than just an interruption to our plans. Paul's death was an unplanned interruption in his life itself. Now, as we've heard already, Paul would be the first to tell you that he lived a long life and a good life. In both his living and his dying, he was the last person to pity himself or really draw any attention to himself. In the past year or so, I noticed a new grandpa-ism, which was new to me. I would call him up and ask him how he was doing, and he would say, "Can't complain." And, you know, I'd press him a little bit and say, "Are you sure, Grandpa? Like, I'm sure you can think of some things to complain about." And he'd think about it and he'd say, "Well, I suppose I could, but it wouldn't do any good." Even for those like Paul who have lived a long life, death is not a natural end. In fact, death is the most unnatural of outcomes because from an ultimate perspective, death was never a part of the plan. On the contrary, God's plan began with life. In Genesis 1, God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, after our likeness." God created male and female. He saw all that he had made, and he said it was very good. And God's good plan for creation involved creating humans as unified physical and spiritual beings, made to live in harmony with one another and with God and show God's image to the world. And when I think about Paul, I think about all of the ways that he bore the image of God. As some have said, he was patient. He was gentle. He was always thinking of the needs of others. He was unceasingly creative. He was quick to listen and slow to speak. He was curious and always willing to learn, unless it had anything to do at all with computer technology. He loved his neighbor as himself. He faithfully loved his wife, Glenadine, for so many years and served her even as her health declined and required a high amount of care. And just like this, God's plan was always that humans would bear his image and continue to display it and live in harmony So when humans rebelled against God, what entered the picture was not according to plan. Chaos entered the picture. We often call this chaos sin, but it ultimately results in death. And death is an ultimate disruption to God's good world. We often talk about sin as something that spiritually separates us from God and from each other, and that's true. But the thing that makes sin's partner death so evil and destructive is that it physically separates things that were never meant to be torn apart. Death separates our souls from our bodies. Death separates our bodies from living in this good world that He created. And death separates us from living in relationship with each other. This is the aspect of chaos and death that we feel most profoundly today. It's because of death's power to tear apart what God created to be whole that the Apostle Paul calls death in 1 Corinthians 15 the last enemy. This week, as the family began to prepare for Paul's funeral, we learned that Paul had left several passages from the Psalms marked in his Bible. One of these Psalms was Psalm 77. And I can't help but wonder if when Paul experienced the passing of Glenadine 4 years ago and the destructive power of death, and maybe again more recently when Paul was reminded of his own mortality, I can't help but wonder if some of these words from Psalm 77 resonated with his experience. This is Psalm 77, verse 7. The psalmist writes, "Will the Lord reject me forever? Will He never show His favor again? Has His unfailing love vanished forever? Has His promise failed for all time? Has God forgotten to be merciful? Has He in anger withheld His compassion?" Maybe these words have new meaning for us this morning as we feel the reality that Paul's life, and indeed every life, is cut short too soon. Based on the way that Paul lived his life and on the way that he faced the possibility of his own death, I believe Paul took the next words of the psalmist to heart. Even when things in life seem to go off the rails and not according to plan, Paul lived the truth of these words. Then I thought, to this I will appeal. The years when the Most High stretched out His right hand, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember Your miracles of long ago. I will consider all Your works and meditate on all Your mighty deeds. And the psalmist continues in the psalm, sharing many ways throughout history that God had shown His presence with His people and His power to save them. The key point in this psalm is that in every circumstance where God showed up to save His people, He stepped into the chaos of our world to rescue and to redeem. At the point in history where the plan seemed most unlikely to succeed, God showed up as one of us in Jesus and showed He was not only powerful, but also present to overcome the chaos of sin and death. You see, Jesus personally understands the tragedy of losing close friends, relatives, even His own human father to the chaotic power of death. Jesus personally relates to questioning God's plan and having unanswered questions about God's wisdom and timing. Jesus personally experienced the pain and the anguish of death, a separation from His own body, from others, and even from God. And Jesus personally experienced the resurrection power of God, which restores and renews all who trust in Him. You see, while death disrupted God's plan for creation at the beginning, death cannot stop God's vision for creation being redeemed in the end. In 1 Corinthians 15, as we've already heard this morning, the Apostle Paul tells of how Jesus' resurrection from the dead is a sneak preview of the resurrection that awaits all those who trust in Jesus, all those who've experienced the separation and interruption of death. And I'll read it one more time. The Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, "Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, The dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. And we await that day with hope when the imperishable resurrection body of our beloved Paul will be raised again to dwell with Jesus and with us. And Jesus' disciple John writes about this reality, this renewed earth that can no longer be touched by the chaos of sin and death. In Revelation 21, he writes, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, no more mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." Let's pray together. Jesus, our great Savior, we praise you that by your death and resurrection, you defeated the dark grip of sin and the chaotic power of death. Jesus, our great healer, we thank you that our brother Paul is no longer suffering, but is present with you in spirit, rejoicing in your presence. Jesus, our great hope, we look forward to one day being reunited with Paul and with all of our loved ones who trust in you, the day when you will dwell with your people forever. Amen.
Amen. Nick, thank you for those words. Thank you for that blessing. Friends, we will now join together our voices in an old hymn. It's an insert in your bulletins this morning, entitled "The Old Rugged Cross." We'll join together in singing verses 1 and 4. Let us sing. Amen. It's a beautiful old hymn, isn't it? It's a beautiful old hymn in which we remember the cross, that even in its symbolism of death, of pain, and of suffering, in which Christ went to that cross for us, we can still cherish it. Because it is through the cross that we are promised life. I have no doubt from hearing these beautiful stories that Paul cherished that cross. Paul understood that cross and that it meant not death, not suffering, but joy, the love of Christ for him, a sinner, who is now perfected in grace, perfected in heaven, healed completely. And I must add, for those who don't know me yet, I'm a Methodist pastor. And here's the ironic thing, or I would say the Holy Spirit moment. That hymn was written by a Methodist pastor 100+ years ago. What a joy it is to sing on this day for you, for God. And it's an honor to be in this holy place with you, to grieve with you, to celebrate Paul's life with you. As Nick pointed out, that beautiful psalm reminds us that he is our rock, our fortress, and that through him all is possible, including the healing of a broken heart, the wiping away of the tears of this day, replaced with smiles and laughter and with song. So may you have the patience to build that plane, to make sure part F goes to part J without putting the glue in just yet, so that it may fly. It'll fly high and forever, just as Paul is now doing. Will you pray with me? God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. This day, Lord, we give you thanks, because it is by his death that Jesus destroyed the power of this death, and it is by his resurrection that he has opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers, that we may see not an empty tomb, yet a tomb filled with your love for us, because Christ is not there. Paul is not in that tomb. He is risen today. He is with Christ in heaven. We may celebrate that. Because in us, Lord, you shall make certain that because Christ lives, we shall live also, that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And just as Jesus has demonstrated on this day through the cross, he has also taught us his words. And I invite you, friends, to join with me now as we say the prayer he taught us, by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend to your servant Paul. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive Paul into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of eternal peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. May we go forth in the peace, in the name of Christ. Amen. Prior to processing out this morning, we will join one last time in song and praise as we will sing from the hymnal number 532, verses 1 and 4, How Great Thou Art.
Awesome wonder, consider all.